Oh, I think it's working. Can you hear me? Good morning and welcome to Ask Me Anything. This is my first time doing a live stream, so I'm sorry for the late start. And my intention is to answer any questions that you might have about things that fall into my areas of music. Hi, Bob Johnston. It's working.
Great. Hi, everybody. Hi, Bob.
Special guest, Jill Daley.
Just for a few minutes.
Yeah. So we are here and we are hunkering down. We're doing our stuff. Hi, Susan Graham Walker. So you can comment in the comment window. You can also, if you're not signed in to YouTube, you can also send me an email. So I've got my emails here. So if anything comes in, I can answer those questions. And so I'm waiting for a question. Yes, I am wearing pants. Nobody asked that question, but that is always the first question when it comes to a live stream. You can even ask Jill something before she runs away.
John Sutton is asking, where are you? We're in our apartment in Mike's little man cave.
The office studio. This is where I make music, record music, write, think, try to figure out what I'm going to say. Yeah. Is the echo gone? I turned down my playback. Are you able to hear me without echo? Okay. Are you planning, our first question, are you planning on returning to Innes sometime soon? We loved your later life talk on the Beatles. You know, I think that I, thank you, Susan, for that check-in about the sound. I believe that I am back at Innes next year. Just looking at my calendar. Sometimes hard for me to, oh, there it is. I am scheduled to return to Innes in the winter of 2021, Friday mornings, starting January 15th. And I'm going to be doing my course on the Toronto Sound and Yorkville in the 1950s and 1960s. So this is a subject that's close to my heart. And it's the subject of the book that I'm writing, though that it's actually turned into two books. So I've divided it into the Yorkville book and the Toronto Sound book, and I'm working on the Yorkville book right now.
So there was a question about our neighbors complaining about sound. John, they don't complain about Mike, but they complain about me. Not the violin, but the piano is very loud for our neighbors. So during this self-isolating time when everyone is home working from home, I check in with my next door neighbor every morning and ask him what time is good for me to practice the piano. And he tells me when his conference calls are, and then I practice in the cracks. So we've made a workaround, and we're all doing our best to keep doing our work and not drive each other crazy.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so question from Stephen Still, who has traveled with us on our tours, and it is about the Bob Dylan song. Big news in the Bob Dylan world with release of Murder Most Foul. And so his first release in years, and he says that it's something that they recorded a while ago. As with Dylan, you can never completely believe what he's saying. He may have recorded it last week, but we don't know. And so if you haven't heard this new 17-minute Bob Dylan song, so the longest song that he has ever released, and that's saying a lot, it's a rumination on the assassination of President Kennedy. And it is really a sprawling affair, kind of a spoken word song that references lots of things about the Kennedy assassination. The title itself is a reference to a 1967 book about the assassination called Murder Most Foul. And then he name checks all kinds of musical artists, historical figures, songs. In fact, I've made a Spotify playlist that's about 2.5 hours long with all of the songs that I can discern that he references in that song. So many songs within a song.
I think it's a good time for me to go.
Okay.
Hi, Stephen and Terry. I hope you guys are both well. There was also, before Mike finishes on that question, there was a question about our Montreal trip. Craig Travel will be in touch with everybody most likely today. Unfortunately, that trip is not going to be able to happen. So they will be emailing everybody with those details. We're hoping to do it next May at the same time. It's pretty heartbreaking for us and everybody. Yeah, so that's where that stands. Carry on. And I hope everybody has a great day. Stay safe. Bye.
So anyway, Murder Most Foul, when it came out that morning that it came out, I had to transcribe the lyrics. So I put a transcription, on my website, but if you want to look up the lyrics now, it's been, somebody has transcribed it. There's a good, lyrics site, called genius.com, and it's, people put up the lyrics and then other people correct it. It's a wiki, you know, it's a collectively created thing, and then people will comment, so they'll highlight different parts of the lyrics and they will give their interpretation. So there's some pretty good stuff up there, and it's changing all the time. So if you want to look at an analysis of the lyrics, but you know, as with anything about Bob Dylan, it reminds me of Walter Yetnikoff's statement to Leonard Cohen in 1984, when Leonard submitted, Walter Yetnikoff was the president of Columbia Records, and Leonard was signed to Columbia, and Leonard was about to release his album, Various Positions, and it had songs like Dancing to the End of Love and Hallelujah on it, and Walter Yetnikoff did not want to release it because it wasn't commercial enough, and he said, Leonard, we know that you're great, we just don't know if you're any good, and that's kind of a thing with Bob Dylan. On the surface of it, it's kind of a weird song. Some of the things seem to not work, especially in the beginning. It's very stiff and awkward, like many of his lyrics are lately. And then if you surrender to it, it will take you on a journey. And it's really unlike anything else that you'll experience. And just exactly what we need is to be able to go down the rabbit hole of trying to figure out what the heck Bob is on about. So if you haven't heard it yet, it's on YouTube, Murder Most Foul by Bob Dylan. And also Stephen sent me an article in the foreword. And so what I can do is I can put that link up at the end, and it looks like a good interpretive article. So I'll put up a link for the lyrics in the comments here, and I'll put up a link for the foreword article. Okay, let's see. So John Sutton asks, why Yorkville? Why am I writing about Yorkville? So I'm writing, my book is on the music scene in Yorkville in the 1950s and 1960s. And my kind of the thesis that I'm working on is that Yorkville was a unique musical ecosystem that was kind of an anomaly of low rents in these old Victorian houses, coinciding with the folk revival changing into, and then, you know, seeing the transition into the years of Beatlemania and then psychedelic rock. So the moment of Yorkville, which I sort of say is about 1955 to 1968. 1968 is when we really begin to see the music scene wane. And in that time, some very interesting music happens there, some very interesting businesses that are kind of operating on a shoestring, these cafes, these coffee houses, like the Village Corner, the Purple Onion, the Half Beat, the Penny Farthing, the Riverboat, and so on. the Minor Bird, Chez Monique, El Patio, the Flick. You get the idea. And, you know, all of these different coffee houses that are coming and going. I'm trying to look at the business aspect, how these places stayed alive, how they adapted to the changing times, changing fashions. But basically my thesis is that these brilliant musicians who came through Yorkville, people like Ian and Sylvia, Gordon Lightfoot, Neil Young, Joni Mitchell, John Kay from Steppenwolf, David Clayton Thomas, that all of them were shaped in decisive ways by that ecosystem and by the characteristics of that ecosystem. So what I'm trying to do is describe what Yorkville really was. And I think there are a lot of misconceptions about what Yorkville, how it worked and what actually happened. So I'm doing some deep research. I'm interviewing a lot of people and I'm trying to put my analytical spin on it. I think it's a fascinating place and a fascinating moment in time that I want to try to explicate. So that's why Yorkville. And it's got a good beat and you can dance to it, which is always a good reason for anything. Okay, so Susan Graham Walker asks, I was out for a walk yesterday and walked past a blue plaque about the Blue Note. So there are heritage plaques around Toronto commemorating historic music venues. And so there's one in front of the Penny Farthing on Yorkville at 110, 112 Yorkville. There's one out in front. There's one out in front of where the Purple Onion was at 35 Avenue Road. There's a campaign now suspended, but a campaign to put a plaque in front of the Village Corner at 174 Avenue Road. And there is one in front of the former site of the Lecoq Door, where Ronnie Hawkins held forth, and which was a really important place for rock and roll and rhythm and blues in the 1960s at 333 Yonge Street. And there's one in front of the Blue Note, which I think is at 372 and a half Yonge Street. It was upstairs. And the Blue Note was an important after-hours rhythm and blues place from 1959 to 1969. And so they would have a house band there that was playing rhythm and blues. And then they would have guest singers that would come late at night to do the floor show. And often because it was an after hours place, rhythm and blues and soul music stars like Stevie Wonder would come in and sit in with the band after hours. And it was just a great scene for 10 years where rhythm and blues and, you know, what we understand as the Toronto sound flourished, and lots of incredible musicians got their start there. It was a historic place where music flourished in the golden years of live music in Toronto. And so it's an important place, and it's going to be part of the story that I tell in my next book, which is on the Toronto sound, trying to define that and trying to look at the scene, especially around Yonge Street. Okay, Rona, are you still hearing an echo? I see that you're saying there's still an echo, but there shouldn't be. I've got my, hello, can you hear me? Okay. I'm experimenting here with, rather than using my computer audio, I'm using a microphone so that I can get better sound. Still an echo. Is it just Rona or anyone else? Okay, well, we'll come back to it. So Bob says, I'm not getting an echo. Fran Cohen, hi Fran, asks, what do you consider to be the first rock and roll song? That is, in fact, there's an entire book about that debate of what the first rock and roll song is. It depends on how you define rock and roll. I happen to define rock and roll in its beginnings as a rebranding of rhythm and blues. And that is that later on in the 50s, we can see that that rock and roll developed in directions away from what was previously known as rhythm and blues. But when Alan Freed coined the term rock and roll, he was trying to rebrand rhythm and blues, which was urban popular music made by African-American people for African-American people, for an adult audience, an urban audience. And rhythm and blues had been flourishing all through the 1940s with artists like Big Joe Turner and Louis Jordan and so on. And so when this music started to cross over to white teenagers, and some, you know, the thing about Alan Freed was that he was a DJ in Cleveland, and he began to host a show that was sponsored by a record store called Record Rendezvous. And the owner of Record Rendezvous was noticing that a lot of white teenagers were coming in wanting to buy rhythm and blues records. And so he wanted Alan Freed to cater to that audience. And Alan Freed's brainwave was to say, let's rebrand this music so that these kids can think of it as a new thing and think of it as their own thing. And so he started calling this music rock and roll. The music didn't change, the name changed. So I guess you could say that the first rock and roll song was the first rhythm and blues song to cross over to a mass white audience, thus spurring the rebranding. So some people have actually said that I think it's the Orioles' Crying in the Chapel, which was a huge hit, I believe, in 1950, you know, which is not what we think of as rock and roll. I mean, it's a ballad, but it was a African-American group crossing over to a huge white teenage audience. Is it rock and roll? Others have looked retro. Now, the other thing, too, is that one of the other candidates is Rocket 88 by Jackie Brenston, which was really Ike Turner's band with Jackie Brenston, the sax player, singing. Some people have retrospectively looked back to that song from 1951, which was recorded at Sun Studio in Memphis. And because there's, you know, there's distorted guitar, and it has what we would think of as a rock sound or a rock and roll sound, we've looked back at that and said, okay, well, that was the first rock and roll song stylistically. But I'm not satisfied with that either. So anyway, to answer your question, I avoid the question. And I say, whatever it means to you, that's the first rock and roll song. A lot of people say Rock Around the Clock because it was such a huge hit in 1955. And for many people, it was their introduction to the idea of rock and roll. It even has the word rock in the title. So maybe you could argue that that is the first rock and roll song. But me personally, because I think of the advent of rock and roll as being a rebranding and not a stylistic shift, I say there is no first rock and roll song, that it was just rebranding. Okay. Christina Shrewsbury, my mother-in-law, asks, hi, Mike. My question is, what has influenced the changes in rock and roll since the early days of the 50s? Those were the days of songs with melody and harmony that stand up to the test of time. Well, I think that as rock and roll has continued and as it has developed, it has had certain core aesthetic qualities. And one of those core qualities is a tendency towards extremism. And that is that if something is loud, we want to make it louder. And that's a way to innovate, is to constantly push it farther and farther. And that's one way to look at the evolution of rock and roll through the 1950s and 1960s, is that you're seeing certain musical qualities being exaggerated. So the guitars get louder, they get more distorted, the music gets faster, the singing gets more and more abrasive, it gets farther and farther away from the kind of bel canto idea of musical beauty that you see even in some of the earlier, if you look at Elvis, he is coming from almost an Italian, his idol was Dean Martin. He's coming from that beautiful voice, almost semi-operatic, popular singing tradition. And so the tendency towards extremism is going to logically take us to heavy metal. It's going to take us to punk rock. And so I think that's been one factor. I think the other thing is that rock and roll, because it's so popular, and has been so popular, and that it happened to catch this huge demographic of the baby boomers, that it became this juggernaut that kind of drew in everything else into its orbit. And so it's a kind of, what would you say, omnivorous, you know, this gaping maw that just kind of sucks in everything in its path. So in the 1960s, rock music draws in folk music, and it basically subsumes folk music in the mid-1960s. And that's why when I do my course on the rock and roll era, I end with Like a Rolling Stone, Bob Dylan in 1965, because I think with that song and, you know, the ratification of this moment to me is that the song gets to number two, the 6-minute song gets to number two on the Billboard charts and number one on the Cashbox charts. It's the moment where folk music and the authenticity of folk music, authenticity, and the lyrical complexity, the emphasis on the lyrics, the intelligence, the progressive nature of it gets drawn into rock and roll. And so we have this transitional piece where we have folk rock, 1965 to 67, and then basically the air is taken out of the sails of folk music in 66 and 67. So rock and roll being this thing that draws in other kinds of music, that's another kind of core quality. So those are a couple of examples that I would say, Christina. Fran, please talk a little bit about the progression of popular music from its African roots through to contemporary music, but more so, where do you think it will go from here? Well, Fran, thank you for keeping your question very limited and specific, first of all, and I'm kidding. Oh boy, please talk a little bit about the progression of popular music. I think that's too big a question to answer, to be honest. Fran, please give me a more specific question. Thank you. All right. Susan Graham Walker, Young and Elm Street. Yes, I think you're talking about the Blue Note. It's not quite Elm Street. It's just down. It's up from Elm Street. Okay. All right. Have you studied jazz? Bob Johnson says, have you studied jazz at the Stratford Festival in the 50s? And hold on here. I just want to remind you that if you're not signed into YouTube and you want to ask questions, you can always email me at mikedaley@gmail.com. Have you studied jazz at the Stratford Festival in the 50s? In July 56, I attended an event including Wilbur de Paris, Willie the Lion Smith, Jimmy Rushing, etc. I'll email you the program. Thank you, Bob. I have not studied that, but I'm dimly aware of it. I know that Duke Ellington had some sort of connection to the Stratford Festival, I think in the 50s. And I think he did some incidental music for a Shakespeare play there. And there have been some jazz connections with Stratford, but no, I haven't looked at it because I've been stuck in Yorkville for 2 years. So Fran Cohen says, just got a message that Bill Withers died age 81. Well, I'm sorry to hear that. Bill Withers of Lean On Me and Use Me and Ain't No Sunshine, wonderful singer-songwriter. And he was the subject of a documentary a few years ago called Still Bill. I haven't seen that yet, but I hope to. Okay. Fran asks, what about art rock? Francis, that was my husband's question. The one where I have to tell the entire history of popular music from beginning to end? Yes. So what about art rock? Well, yeah, I would say that art rock, depending on how you define art rock, because art rock has a few different definitions. I mean, I think that one of the, you know, I was mentioning how rock has this omnivorous quality where it takes in all of these other things under its umbrella and everything becomes hyphenated rock, you know, country rock, folk rock, art rock. And I think art rock is what happened when you had a generation of rock musicians who grew up with rock music, who grew up with the Beatles. And I think the Beatles in many ways are gateways to what happens later on in rock music, because the Beatles gave us a proof of concept for all kinds of things, like that you could combine qualities of classical music with rock music. And they showed that with things like Eleanor Rigby and Strawberry Fields Forever. And so this idea that you can take classical music and that you can fuse it with rock music, I think, is seeded in the 1960s, not just the Beatles, but lots of the Moody Blues were doing it with their Days of Future Past. And, you know, lots of other groups were finding ways. So you've got these musicians who are rock, raised on rock and raised on the aesthetics of rock and the sounds of rock and rock instrumentation and all of that. But they also perhaps have some classical training, and they want to combine the complexity of classical music and some of the sounds of it with rock music. And so it's only natural, but it could only have happened after the 1960s, because you had to have this generation of musicians who were raised on rock music, understood it, and had internalized it enough to be able to combine it with the qualities of classical music. Judith Davy says, I attended your seminars in Mississauga about the Beatles. Do you have a favorite Beatles song and why? I don't know. Yes and no. I have a favorite Beatles song. I would say that if I had to pick, it would be Strawberry Fields Forever, because to me that song has it all. You may know from my Beatles course that I lean a little bit towards Team John as far as my favorite songwriter in the Beatles, and that's primarily a John song. I love the story of how it was put together, how they recorded these two versions and then they stitched them together. They slowed one down, sped another one up. They were in different keys and they managed to fit together. I love pointing out the moment right at the 1 minute mark where you go from the one version to the other version. I love the lyrics. The nostalgia in it is wonderful. The way that it harkens back to John's childhood in Liverpool and what Strawberry Field represented to him. By the way, Strawberry Field just opened in Liverpool. The old Salvation Army orphans home is now open to the public, though I'm sure closed at the moment. So anyway, I just love that. I love the sounds. I love the combination of the rock instruments, all the percussion in it. You know, they've got all these different drums and percussion going through the whole thing, and the strings and the horns. It's got everything. So I just love that one. Okay. Stephen Still asks, 100 years from now, who still gets the most tweets? Or the 22nd century equivalent, Elvis, Beatles, Dylan, or Justin Bieber? That's a serious question. And you're asking who will be remembered 100 years from now. And I think that I don't know. I think there's... If you've taken my Beatles course in the last lecture, if I have time, sometimes I talk about the nostalgia curve of different cultural products, and that the different ways that when something gets famous and then you've got its sort of wanes and then it enters its historical period and it will continue from that time. I think that. There's a good possibility that the Beatles will cease to be. There's two different things. There's the Beatles as a household word, and there's the Beatles as a historical thing. Now, I think that Elvis, Beatles, Bob Dylan will all be in the history books for hundreds of years. Justin Bieber, I'm not sure. Though generations do tend to commemorate themselves. I think though that there will be a point maybe in the next 50 years when there will be a lot of people who have never heard of the Beatles or Elvis or Bob Dylan. Just like there are a lot of people who have never heard of Beethoven and have never heard of Mozart. And a big reason that we know about Mozart and Beethoven is that their music continues to be played. And the thing about Beatles music and Elvis music and Dylan music is that these are recordings. And so people have to go back to the recordings. It's not music that's designed to be reproduced year after year after year. So I don't know. Get back to me in 100 years and I'll answer definitively. Okay, so that's the end of the questions that I'm seeing. Does anybody want to get one in, or are there any? Oh, here's some more questions. Okay, so this is in my email, and you can always send a question to my email at mikedaley@gmail.com. Hey, Mike, this is from Joe Slomka in Hamilton. Hi, Joe. Hey, Mike, talk a little bit about Chuck Berry. Some say Elvis was the king. I beg to differ. Enjoying this very much, Joe. Thank you, Joe. Chuck Berry, well, I mean, it's apples and oranges talking about Chuck Berry and Elvis Presley. Chuck Berry was a songwriter, and he was an instrumentalist. And so he had influence. I mean, people have called Chuck Berry the first poet of rock and roll, and I would tend to agree. That is, he was the first rock and roll songwriter who really mastered the art of the rock and roll lyric. And, you know, even though he was, you know, in his early 30s when he breaks through, he really understood teenage concerns, and he spoke for the teenager with songs like School Day and Rock and Roll Music. By the way, can anybody hear the cat scratching at the door? Do you hear him? This is what I deal with. He hears me talking and he's like, I know you're in there. Why aren't I in there? Because you scratched the chair, mister. That's why. Anyways, so Chuck Berry, this, you know, great songwriter, but also this wonderful guitarist who not only influenced all the guitar players in the way that he played, and but also, you know, he's the one who really, I think, makes the change from the saxophone to the guitar in rock and roll being the central solo instrument and the kind of talisman of rock and roll instruments, you know, because of how cool he looked with the duck walk and everything. And look, Elvis also popularized the guitar in a huge way. The king of rock and roll, look, those are all just marketing terms anyway. Elvis was his popularity. You can't deny the importance of Elvis's popularity for the dissemination of rock and roll. You know, for people in 1956, rock and roll was Elvis. And, you know, Bill Haley may have had priority on the charts, but Elvis was the one who had the whole package. And so he was the one who really coalesced this pop culture idea of rock and roll with the rebelliousness and the curled lip and the look and the thing. So what can you say? I love them both. Just a slight meow. Okay, so you can hear Mister. There you go. You're famous, Mister. Okay, so what contribution did Jerry Lee Lewis make to rock and roll? Well, Jerry Lee Lewis is absolutely one of the, he's on the Mount Rushmore of early rock and roll, along with Elvis, with Chuck Berry, Little Richard. I'd put him up there. And, you know, Jerry Lee Lewis, you know, it's really amazing the number of rock and roll figures of stars who came out of Sun Records in Memphis, Sam Phillips. And, you know, when Sam Phillips sold Elvis Presley's contract to RCA for, I think, $30,000, you know, people say, oh, what a fool, he lost all that money. But, you know, he wasn't able to sustain Sun Records with, Elvis was too big for Sun to handle. It was an independent record company. It was a small distribution network. He needed to sell Elvis's contract. And besides, he took some of the money and invested it in Holiday Inn, which was a new Memphis-based hotel franchise. So he did all right. And another thing was that he was able to invest in new artists like Johnny Cash and Carl Perkins and Jerry Lee Lewis. And Jerry Lee, I mean, he, in many ways, he's the personification of rockabilly, right? The rocking hillbilly, that he's a white guy from the South, absorbed the sound of rhythm and blues, absorbed the sound of country music, and fused the two together. And when we talk about sort of the second wave of rock and roll being rockabilly in the mid-1950s, that's where you really begin to get a stylistic shift to something that is not just a rebranding of rhythm and blues, but that has, you know, that has these stylistic qualities from country music, from gospel music, New Orleans music, and of course rhythm and blues. All of those things all together, you have something that's really different, and you have a new genre of music called rock and roll. So I think he's one of the people that really defines, and you know, defines sort of the bad boy, the killer, right, aspect. And so hugely important. And a great country singer too. You know, after he was blackballed in the late 1950s, after it was discovered that he'd married his 13-year-old cousin, he turned to country music, and country radio embraced him, and he made some great, great records. So, and he's the last man standing. I mean, amazingly, Jerry Lee is still with us, and he is the last of the original, you know, rock and roll legends who is still around. Okay. Just a slight meow. Yes, he's singing. Will you be doing an online course for Ryerson? Yes, I will. I'm going to be doing a course for Life Institute, and that will be in, hold on, let me bring that up. So for Life Institute, it's coming up soon, actually. And it's going to be starting the week, well, May 5th is the first one. And so the lectures are going to be going live. The first one, I think, is going to go live around May 2nd, and then we're going to do live question periods like this. In fact, I'm doing this for all of my online stuff. After I, you know, do the lecture, I do a question period where you can write in questions, and it'll be live. So the subject is Neil Young for this, and it's a new course that I've been planning for a while. And so for Life Institute, I do these courses, Words and Music, and so I started with Words and Music, Bob Dylan, I think, and then Joni Mitchell, Leonard Cohen, and so this is Words and Music, Neil Young. So I'm going to be doing a full career survey of Neil Young and of his work, of his life, and try to get at what kind of artist he is, deal with his musical output in its entirety. And so we'll see how it goes. So that's going to be my offering for Life Institute. And I'm going to be doing for Hot Docs, this will be announced soon, but I'll be doing folk music. So a history of folk music, basically Anglo, North American folk music. And that will be an online course as well. Let's see. Oh, and I had another question on the email from Jane Gilmore. I love Carole King, especially her Tapestry album. Have you ever done a course or talked much about her work and her incredible songwriting capabilities? I would love to hear your thoughts. Thank you, Jane. I have a single lecture on Carole King, and Jill and I have done a lecture concert at Hugh's Room on the life and music of Carole King. So at some point, we may do an online version. We used a singer, though, for that. So we may not be able to do it during these times. But yeah, I do have sort of what I call my one-offs, and I do have a Carole King one. So hopefully I'll be able to present that either online in some form or in person. So that is my answer. Okay, another question. Frank Sinatra. Yes, I vaguely hear the cat. He's being quiet at the moment. And no echo here. Okay, good. Will people remember Frank Sinatra as they remember Elvis, the Beatles, et cetera, et cetera? Yeah, you know, I think it's, I think that Sinatra is, he seems to be hanging on in the popular culture, you know, still very much known. It helps that he made so many movies. And so he still has a sort of visual trace that people can hang on to. But yeah, I think when the baby boom generation is gone, I think we're going to see a very, very changed pop culture landscape. And nobody wants to hear that. But I think it's true. I think that, and that's natural that there, you have to make room in people's mental space for new phenomena. And so, it's hard to say, you know, but I could be wrong. I mean, Sinatra's music has a classic quality. People keep coming to it. They keep coming back to it. We listen to it. It still sounds great today. The things he did in the 40s and the 50s, especially in the 50s, those great albums in the Wee Wee Hours and, you know, Songs for Swingin' Lovers, those great Nelson Riddle, Billy May and Gordon Jenkins arrangements. I mean, there's a classic quality to that music. Same as the Beatles, you know, the Beatles music, almost none of it has aged in a way where I think, oh, that's like a, you know, that's a period piece. You know, it sounds as fresh to me today as well. I mean, it always, to me, it was always a period piece because I wasn't there at the time, but it's always sounded fresh and now, and somehow it's a classic. Okay. Oh, thank you, Bob. Registration for Life is on April 13th. Yes. Great. And Phil Renzoni says, I heard that Jerry Lee was self-taught on piano. I don't know for sure, but I would bet, because there were no lessons in rock and roll piano in the 40s and 50s. I mean, now you can take lessons in any style, but you know, to take formal lessons in any instrument, I would say up to the 70s, you could not learn rock and roll formally. If you were taking lessons, it was classical music up until, I'd say, maybe the 50s. And then in the 50s, there were a few teachers who would teach you how to play jazz, and that's it. I mean, there was no rock and roll method. In fact, when I started playing guitar in the early 80s, there were very, very few books that I could get that would teach me how to play rock, that teach like guitar licks for rock. There was very, very little. And that's in the 80s. So it's been slow going. And now, of course, if anybody wants to play anything, they can fire up YouTube and there's a lesson on how to, you know, do the guitar solo and Stairway to Heaven and all those things that were mysteries to us. Stephen Still, even if you don't like rap, do you still respect it in that a new music style was created? Well, yeah, I mean, I think rap music is the whole idea that poetry would have such a comeback and that it would be so hugely popular is to me so exciting. I mean, aside from musical factors, and there's lots of incredible things musically going on in rap, but just the idea of it, that lyrics and that social consciousness would have such a central stage in pop culture, to me, is wonderful. And you know, if you don't like it, it's not meant for you. That's the thing, is that, you know, generations, part of how we define our individuality is by upsetting the older generation and making them not like what we like, so that we can define ourselves in opposition. And so, you know, the repellent quality of new music, if you feel that, is it's a feature, not a bug. All right. Are there any more questions? I am now live on my channel. Yes, I am. Oh, and there's the Bill Withers So he died at 81. He was a three-time Grammy winner, and he died from heart complications. So rest in peace, Bill Withers. Okay. How about a song? Let's finish with a Bill Withers song. I just happen to have a guitar here. Let's do it here. Sometime in our lives, we all have pain. We all have sorrow. But if we are wise, we know that there's always tomorrow. Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on. Please swallow your pride if I have things you need to borrow for. Those of the things that you don't let show. You just call on me, brother, when you need a hand. We all need somebody to lean on. I just might have a problem that you understand. We all need somebody to lean on. Lean on me when you're not strong. I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on. If there is a load that you can't bear, if you can't bear live, folks, I'm up the road, I'll take the load. If you just call me when you need a friend. Call me, yeah, yeah, call me, yeah, yeah. Thank you, everyone. You've made my morning. Everybody stay safe, be well, and let's do this again. I'll send it. We'll do it next month or something. I'll send out a link. I've got a Bob Dylan lecture coming up next week for Beach United. That's going to be online. Links on the email that I sent out on my newsletter. If you want to be on my newsletter and you're not on my newsletter, go to mikedaleymusic.com and there's a sign up right on the front, or just email me and I'll send it to you. I also have a lecture series on the Beatles that I'm offering, that's starting in the middle of April, 8 lectures on the Beatles, pre-recorded, so I won't mess up anything. And that's going to be my usual thing, combining video and music and pictures and me talking and all of that. And let's see what else. Also, I'm doing the series for the Toronto Symphony Volunteers Committee on three great singers of the 20th century, Bing Crosby, Judy Garland, and Frank Sinatra. It's for a great cause for the symphony. Please do what you can for these arts organizations like the symphony that are trying to keep it together in extremely tough times. So thank you all, and I'll see you again soon. Take care.